So welcome. It's just a pleasure to be here with you today. My name is Marilee Bresciani Ludvik, and I have the privilege of serving as a professor here at ARP, which is Administration, Rehabilitation, and Post-Secondary Education. So Polly invited me, thank you Polly, to talk to you a little bit about the neuroscience for well-being. How many of you are here because you feel that you are healthy and just want to get a little bit more science behind why you're healthy? All right, cool. How many of you are here because you're struggling with this notion of balance, whatever that means, or Okay, cool. And what other reasons are you here? What are you needing to get out of this hour that we have together, or less than an hour? Tools for? Okay. All right, great, thank you. So some tools, some day-to-day, very practical strategies to implement. All right, yes.
Yeah, Polly's email said something about team building, and so I was curious as to how team building connected with it.
Great, okay. So how does team building connect? Okay, great, thank you for that. I'm not sure we'll cover that fully, but we'll touch on it. Thank you for putting that in my head. Yes. Yes. Oh, it's my favorite topic. And what motivated this line of research that's taken me about a decade to feel finally confident in sharing in public. So that's what we'll be just sharing a little snippet of that. Thank you. And it did stem out of this notion of well-being and this notion that I don't know how you're experiencing higher education, but my experience of it has been pretty chaotic. It's pretty chaotic. And actually not so compassionate. It's been like this tendency toward drive and all-consuming process of first as an administrator, just trying to meet all the needs that there are, and there are so many, and then moving into full-time faculty and being consumed again with this publish and perish type of feeling, and also addressing the needs of students, which are vast. And especially with regard to student success. So today, what we'll just cover a little bit is, so that's not working. We have a little bit of a frozen technology. Oh, there we go. Thank you. It's tired. Some definitions around what do we mean by strategies for well-being, the science behind it, and some of the practices so you can take away the tools. So first, what I'd like to have you chat about in dyads, I think there are enough for dyads, just connect with someone, and discuss the sources of stress. What are your sources of stress, and what do you feel you can do about those? So go ahead and get into pairs and chat away, and I'll interrupt you.
Sure.
Please take about 30 seconds to wrap up your conversations. 30 seconds to wrap up your conversations. Okay. Interrupting your conversations, forgive me, and inviting your attention back into the front of the room. So what were some things that arose in your conversations for you? What are some of your sources of stress, and what do you feel you can do about them? So first, perhaps your sources of stress.
Work.
Okay, so let's unpack work. What about work? What is it about work?
Too much to do, so little time.
Too much to do, so too little time to do it in. Okay, and you had your hand up. Thank you.
Oh, I was just gonna say
family. And what about family? Lots of energy. Yeah. So the attention, the demands of attention, mm-hmm. expectations of attention, yeah. is that? And expectations of work, right? What else? What other are other sources of stress?
Uncertainty.
Thank you. Yeah. Uncertainty. Can you speak more to uncertainty? Yeah. So yeah, just things pop up like, oh, I didn't plan for that. That's not in my schedule. No. Right. Right. Yes. Beautiful. Anything else?
Well, yes. Just following up on that, even more general stuff like, you know, not knowing is the stock market going to tank, you know, and we're going to be plunged into there's so much.
Right.
I mean, we, the older I get, the more I realize I have absolutely no control over
Yeah, so all of these things that are facing us in the news, like just open the news and I immediately feel stress and fear and all of these things, like, is that, will there be enough water? Will there be enough food? This means that we've been counting on, will it be there? Yeah, all of this stuff, uncertainty. Yes, and you had your hand up? Yeah, thank you. Not being in control. And that, and tell me more about that. Like,
I think it's kind of general with everything. It's like being told what to do with everything. It's kind of, definitely the uncertainty goes under that category too.
Yeah.
Well, I want it to be like this. I want something where I can kind of control what I'm, like, what's going on around me and whatnot, but that's not the case.
Yeah. Yeah. So, thank you. So, yeah, thank you. Yes. Yeah. So this expectation that I need to be in control, or this expectation of even a desire to be in control, or the awareness that I can't control this, just sort of, and sitting with all of that sort of discomfort. So what is, when we, thank you for unpacking that so quickly and so beautifully. When we think about this idea of expectations, which may be underlying a lot of our sources of stress, like even if this expectation of I should be able to do something about this and I can't, or I should be able to respond to this and I can't, what is underlying that? And I don't mean going into the we're not going to do psychoanalysis here, or psychotherapy, but what's under, just something that's underlying that?
Well,
Fear. Okay. And fear is fear experienced in physiology or is it a thought?
Both.
Beautiful. You guys rock. Yes. So fear of whatever is experienced physiologically in the body, and it's also a thought. I can't, or I'm going to disappoint, or I am disappointing, right? Either me or this other person, right? Whatever it is. So when we know this, then, and when we realize that it actually is simple but not easy, then we immediately have something we can do about it. And that is simply breathing. Isn't that funny? So just inviting now, just thinking about that stressful conversation we had, and now just inviting you to focus on your breath, whatever that means to you, for just a moment. Whatever that means to you, just focus on your breath. And just noticing when a thought may be arising, and then just saying, oh, I'm just going to focus on my breath. And what are you noticing now? You're sleepy? Yeah. So tell me about sleepy. Did you notice a relaxation in your body? Yeah. Physiological relaxation?
Yeah.
And what did that, where did you notice that? Yeah, where did you notice that in your body, physiologically?
Just a little bit more relaxed, not as jittery.
Yeah. In your muscles or?
Yes.
Okay, no, that's okay. Yeah, whatever you notice is whatever you notice. Yeah. Thank you. What else did you notice? Yes.
I felt my brain shut off in the sense that I was focusing on my breathing. I kind of stopped thinking about all the 20,000 things that I have floating around in the back of my mind. I literally was just kind of thinking about my breath, so everything else was shut down. I guess in that sense, I felt less stressed.
Okay. Thank you. Yes, what else? Yes. Awareness. Can you speak to that? Yeah, we're breathing. Or for a long time, I realized when I'm really stressed, I'm not breathing. Like, and so I had to put stickums on my computer and on my iPhone for a long time to say breathe. Because I noticed when I got really anxious, I stopped breathing. And I would literally like, when someone asked me a question, it was hilarious. Good, thank you. So awareness that you are breathing. Good, what else? Anything else? Yes.
It's more like you're in the moment now instead of the past or the future.
Yeah.
It's kind of a fear, afraid of the future, or you're worried about something that happened in the past, but just the focus on your breath is none of that. Right now.
Yeah, it just takes you right, boom, I'm breathing. I'm just simply here in this chair, in this room, very, very safe. Very nourished.
It puts you more in control, too. Just a little bit more. And I always think about, in childbirth and how, when you're preparing for that, that's the thing they teach you right up front, is breathing. And the same, when you're trying to relax. So it's just kind of interesting how powerful that the breath is.
It is. Thank you. It is so powerful. And you're right. You actually have control to bring your attention back to your breath at any given moment you choose. Isn't that amazing? And again, the breath is so so powerful that we know that it can alter our whole physiology. So there's a thought. The thought is, I'm going to choose to focus on my breath. And we're actually literally thinking about our breath in and out. So our brain doesn't really shut down, but it just directs our attention toward the breath. Yeah, we're choosing the breath. We're returning our physiology to that place where stress may not have a detrimental impact on our physiology. Now, stress is not a bad thing. However, when we're not aware of what acute or chronic stress is beginning to create in our body, then we can create deep patterns for unhealthiness. And I have a living example of deep patterns, of creating deep patterns of unhealthiness from not monitoring my stress. And so that's why I had this personal motivation to find out a little bit more of what can I do about being healthier, and what's within my locus of control, because I can't control any of that stuff. I cannot control expectations of anyone around me. I cannot control what's happening in the world. The only thing that's within my ability to regulate is this. And sometimes I don't even feel like that's in my ability to regulate, right? But this is what's powerful. And so in education, we're doing a lot of work with noticing when we use the breath to ease students' anxiety, stress and anxiety, what are we noticing in the moment, which we call a state? Like, can they breathe and then before a test and then take a test and do better on the test? The answer is yes. I'm interested, and my colleagues are interested, in more trait physiology. How do we actually create changes in our neurological structure, particularly in the brain, so that when stress arises, I have quicker access on demand to noticing what is arising in my body and making a choice to return to the breath? And then there's something also cognitively pretty powerful about what happens next. Okay. So the strategy that we have researched the most around, we meaning the broader context of the world of people who are researching this and its effectiveness, is a practice called focused breathing, or you may read about it in literature as meditation. We call it focused breathing in our work because we want to, we don't want to disrespect the wisdom traditions that created this practice of meditation. And we don't want to limit people's accessibility because they're concerned that they might have to forego their faith or their religious beliefs to practice this. So we just call it focused breathing because, quite frankly, that's what we teach. Focus on your breath. And this is the Merriam-Webster's definition. It's just a mental exercise. So it's not a religious practice. It's not meant to stop thinking altogether. If you did that, you would be dead. And we're not promoting that. And it's not a replacement for physician's care. So yes, it's been highly effective for treating physical diagnoses and mental diagnoses, but we don't recommend just taking this up. My research is now in promoting attention, emotion, and cognitive regulation. It's intended to return locus of control to the student so the student can feel more empowered about whatever is unfolding for them in their learning and development experience, and they can feel empowered through choice. And so that's what we're doing with our research. So what does this look like? Want to practice it? All right, cool. So the invitation now is to, again, sit comfortably in your chair, whatever that means to you, and simply notice where your feet are placed. Perhaps you want to feel both of your feet on the floor. Feel your sit bones in the chair, gently directing your attention to that. Directing your attention into your back, feeling it against the back of the chair, or perhaps you're lifting off the chair. And then inviting in this alert spine, yet relaxed posture. Now, inviting attention into your face, whatever that means to you. Perhaps noticing your eyes. And inviting your eyes to gently close or look down on something as if you're looking at it but not really seeing what's there, something not moving. And then inviting attention into the breath, again, whatever that means to you. Perhaps you're thinking, breathe in, breathe out. Perhaps you're noticing the rise and fall of your chest. Perhaps you're noticing whether the air is warm or cool, dry or moist. And then whenever your attention moves to a sound in the environment, simply label it as sound. And gently, kindly, direct your attention back to your breath. Again, just noticing sound, naming it sound. Inviting attention back to your breath. If your attention moves away to a bodily sensation, just notice it without going into the story of whether it should be there. Gently guiding your attention back to your breath. And if you notice thoughts, just simply observe them. Maybe even name them, planning, worry, anticipation. And then gently guide your attention back to your breath. Then, whenever you're ready, wiggle your fingers and your toes. Invite your attention back into the room. And pick up your pen and paper, or pencil and paper, and write about your experience. Just what you had noticed without judgment. And then inviting you to actually stand up, find somebody you maybe don't know very well, and share your experience. Or something else that you want to talk about. And notice as you share that sometimes you're speaking and sometimes you're listening. So finding a partner, I think we'll have one triad. Yeah, we'll have one triad. I wanted to give you that awareness.
Right, right.
Okay.
That's fine.
Okay. So, thank you. How was that experience for you? What did you discover? What questions do you have? What would you like to share with your colleagues?
For the second part? The
yeah.
Part, I like that.
Any part?
You the, kind of hear similarities. So, like, her experience with certain things was kind of similar to mine. Oh, yeah, me too. I thought that. Or so it's comforting to find out that it's not just you, you know, that your mind wanders or you can't do this or whatever. So
yeah, beautiful. Thank you. Yeah, the mind wandering is actually normal. Like, that's really how we are created. And it goes back to the primitive part of the brain, right? And let me just jump ahead here to this. It goes to this primitive part of the brain where our limbic system, not happy light today, our limbic system, our emotional center, in order for us to survive, is always on search, right? Can I eat this or will it eat me? So we're always searching. Like, that's part of our survival. So mind wandering is normal, Right? There's nothing wrong with you. William James has said, imagine. Yeah, yeah, yay. I'm normal.
Well, whatever that means.
So William James has commented on, think about the power of an educational system that trains people to bring back a wandering attention on demand. And I think, oh, yeah, that's rather insightful, right? What if we could teach ourselves and teach our students and our colleagues to bring back their wandering attention on demand? Completely normal to have wandering attention, but what if we could? And the beauty is, we can. Yeah. So what other experiences did you have?
Yes. And do you have, are there ways to, is that enculturation or conditioning?
Great question. Thank you. And I don't want to usurp talking about your experiences. But, so with your permission, I'll go ahead and do this, and then we can just chat about, whatever you want to chat about, because I love this stuff. Thank you. So this is... what you're talking about, again, is neuroscientists have called it our default mode. Our default mode is to ruminate, to wander, to go into the past, to go into the future, to make up stories. One of my colleagues who's a neuroscientist at Google says the mind is the brain, let me rephrase that, the brain is a storytelling machine. It makes stuff up, right? And but what's really cool is this notion of neuroplasticity. Have you heard of that? Yeah, it's getting pretty pop. It's catching a lot of popular press. And this is an image of my brain, in case you're wondering if I had one. And so hopefully nobody throws up. Sometimes I had one person gag and almost throw up when I was showing them the image of my brain. And this is an image just taken at the Keck Center at UC San Diego. And the point of it is that With neuroplasticity, we know that we can reroute neural pathways so that we can actually train attention. So your insight of, oh, I just noticed my mind is wandering. Now I'm going to direct it back to where I want it to be, to place it, is the practice. It's the practice. And we train it with the focused breathing. I'm paying attention to my focused breath. Now my mind is wandering. Ah. My mind is wandering. Train it back to the focused breathing. Ah, noise. Now I'm caught up in, ooh, I wonder what that is. I wonder if they're doing construction. I wonder if, I'm focusing on my breath. And we do that in a way that's really gentle. Right? And just an illustration, everybody look to this side of the room. Now look to this side of the room. Was that effortful for you to do? Yeah, so that's just how we're training, right? Really effortful. Nobody just went and jerked her like, ooh, pay attention over here now, right? Like, none of that. It's just really effortless. It's like, focusing on my breath. I'm not. I'm focusing on my breath. And what we're doing then is practicing in this controlled laboratory of focused breathing. And then when we move out into the world, whatever that means to you, then we're also just applying that practice, real gentleness and kindness. I'm noticing anger arising toward this person who has unreasonable expectations of me. I see the anger. I feel the anger. Now I'm going to focus back on my breath because ruminating, I can't do anything about those expectations. I can't. Right? Now focusing on the breath, doing what I can do in this moment. Does that make sense? Okay. So neuroplasticity, what we're doing over this, starting with this focused breathing training, is literally rewiring structures in the brain, and we can intentionally change the structure and therefore functions of the brain through these practices. And what we're doing is we're down-regulating the amygdala, which is that source of fight or flight or freeze, right? The thing that makes me go, I'm not going to direct this to you. You idiot! I can't believe you're talking like that. To, okay, breathe. Yes, I feel anger. Yes, I feel disrespected. Yes, I feel like I'm acknowledging, I'm feeling. And when I breathe, I soothe this. And then what comes back online is the prefrontal cortex. I'm overgeneralizing, but the prefrontal cortex part of the brain. And that's where we get our access to executive functions like prioritizing, decision making, language processing, right? Analytical reasoning. So think about this. This is just being human. When this fight or flight gets ignited, it was important for our ancestors, like, ooh, lion, better run, not stop and go, is this lion going to eat me? Because then, you know, you're done, and right? But so that's, we're just wired that way. And what's really cool, though, is that we have the capability through practice, something as accessible as just our breath, focusing on our breath, to rewire our brain and then create this little bit of a space for reflection between ignite emotion and breathe and choose, respond. Is that making sense to you? Yeah. And this, when I found this out, I was so happy because I don't have a normal brain, which is why I'm so subject of a study. It's like very emotional, very emotional, activated brain. And then I thought, yay, there is nothing wrong with me. And if I want to be a social human being and have good relationships, working relationships or relationships with family and friends, I need to intentionally train my brain. And what we focus on does change the structure and function of our brain. So if you want to focus on stress and anxiety, anger, what somebody did wrong, you are creating those very, very quick, it's like the paths we see on campuses where you see where students have walked, like those are repeated movements, right? That's just like the brain. Now, if people stop walking on that grass, will grow over. That path is still there, but it's less accessible. Isn't that fun? And there's so much more to this around, this is the quick part of the well-being, and there's a whole lot more with learning and development that we are exploring and compiling into this book that will get published this year. I had one too many neuroscientists involved. No, that's not true. It's better because of that, I think. But there's a lot going on. And so we can intentionally change the brain, and we can do that in a number of ways. Focused breathing is the one that we introduced here in a moment, in the previous moments. That one we have the most research on, about what it does change. And we notice again that it changes portions of the prefrontal cortex, the anterior cingulate cortex, which is in the cortex, the insula, which is body awareness, hippocampus, memory, right? And the amygdala, which is fight or flight. These are all, think about these for all their roles in learning and development and relationships and stuff. I want to emphasize something very important here. Damasio was a neuroscientist at USC, has shown that ignoring emotions is actually bad for decision making. Right? So what we're really training here is awareness, and we do this through several activities, but the awareness of the body, awareness of emotions arising, attention toward that, anger arising, happiness arising, anxiety arising, like awareness of all of that, not a suppression or ignoring. Because that is a key part in helping us access the prioritization for choice. Isn't that interesting? And again, think about, again, our survival patterns, right? Our survival, the way we're wired to survive. So this is important for us to just then become aware. And we can train body awareness through, this looks like sleeping, but it's the body scan. And actually, let's do just a quick focused, this would be what I call focused breath with movement or Tai Chi. There are more studies done on Tai Chi than yoga, but studies are emerging. Compassion training, which I love. Journaling, the pen to paper, the reflection, the ability to have really a conversation with yourself and discover, and all of these discoveries. So do you want to just try one more practice? Yeah. And this one is, in case you're working with a colleague or a family member who is like, I can't sit still and focus on my breath. Please don't ask me to do that. I was absolutely one of those people. I just ran out of the room. Like, I didn't want to be alone with whatever was going on upstairs. You know, and one of my colleagues said, don't go there alone. It's a bad neighborhood. You know, so it's like, yes, it is. So the short version of the story is, to strengthen my practice, I practice focused breathing with movement. And the invitation here is just to stand, if that feels comfortable to you. Yeah, and you can set your goodies down on your chair. And again, first notice your weight on your feet, just feeling your feet on the floor. And perhaps even inhaling, shifting your weight onto your right foot. Exhaling, shifting your weight onto your left foot. And then just noticing inhaling, moving to the right. Exhaling, moving to the left. Now inhaling, feeling your weight distributed on both of your feet. Exhaling, feeling alert and relaxed. And inhaling, just lifting your right arm above your head to whatever height feels comfortable. Exhaling, lowering your right arm. Inhaling, lifting your left arm. Exhaling, lower. Inhaling both arms. Exhaling, lower. And then just simply inviting you to sit back down and share. What did you notice with that short, very short exercise?
Yeah. Oh, okay. It's kind of cool to have two things to focus on, not just one.
Two things to focus on. Ah, and what was easier?
Not letting outside influences come in.
So focusing on movement with breath was easier for you to not become distracted with wandering sound.
Two things to keep my attention, I guess, than just one.
Thank you. Yeah. Polly?
I was nice to feel the ground and then sit. I don't need any stretch or two things, but I just want to.
Thank you. Yeah, just, isn't that fun? Just noticing all that is around us that supports us, really every moment of every day that we take for granted. The fact that you can stand, the fact that you can breathe without support. Pretty cool stuff. Yeah, good. Anything else that you noticed? So addressing your point of it's easier to train attention when there are two things to focus on. What we actually understand to be true about the brain is we can actually only direct our attention toward one thing at one time. It's actually the wisdom of your brain, basal ganglia primarily, that allows that for you just to think lift arm and the arm lifts. Like, I don't have to think, okay, lifting arm, engage hand, lift arm. Like, I don't have to think about the whole process, right? I just lift arm, lower arm. But this beautiful piece of what we call task switching, like I'm going to inhale and lift arm and exhale, lower arm. This movement, again, thinking about our origin of our survival brain, this will help, is a great place for people to begin to train attention. And that was my pathway, and I'm very grateful for it. Practicing that before I could sit and focus on my breathing and when I could move anyway. Good. Other questions about these practices? I'm doing this very quickly, right? So overgeneralizing a lot, but yeah. You look like you had a question.
No.
Why that's happening, because there's activity. There's this movement.
So there's more places for you, so you can switch your attention.
Yeah, the attention is switching. I've given you permission now to, just simple, you have permission now to focus on either or. Right? So did you notice you were either focusing on, okay, lifting hand, okay, now inhaling. Okay, lowering hand, now exhaling. Right? So that's an attention switch. Yeah. And this important discovery, because one of the concerns around our training, attention, emotion, and cognitive regulation is folks will say, well, I don't want to become a zombie, or I don't want to become emotionless. And we're explaining to them that through the practices, once you can begin to become aware of where your primary attention is in the moment, then you can move out into open awareness. And what this does for creativity is pretty profound. So just like you were noticing the floor, and you, if you don't mind, can I share?
Yeah.
And you were noticing, like, wow, my body was a little more tense than I thought it was. Like, you begin to notice a lot more of what you didn't notice before. And that is all information. And all that information can be used to inform decisions. So it's our, we get more into this in our doctoral course, like second year, with then beginning to suspend judgment of what you think is there, inviting an open attention, and then you might see actual solutions or hear people's suggestions differently than you heard it before. And it's really empowering, especially for creative solutions and problem solving. Isn't that fun? Love this stuff. Good. All right. So honoring your time with 6 minutes left, just a simple invitation. And Polly has some, I think you have those practices from the SIY retreat. Feel free to share with, yeah. So we have some sort of practical things that you can do, and one is just simply taking one focused breath every day. And a lot of the students begin their practice with maybe having a sticky note on their door. Like, I walk out of my office, I take a focused breath, I walk back in. We also teach, you know, focused breathing with walking. So I was practicing that when I was coming over from my office over here. And it just gives me an opportunity to really reset my physiology from the anxiety that I was experiencing in the moment in the meeting before, with all of these expectations, feeling all these expectations and all my thoughts of, oh, I don't think I can do that. I don't know how to get, you know, all that. And then just resetting, right, as I walk across campus and noticing things. And the invitation is to move up over time to 30 minutes a day. And why do we say that? Because we know from research that if you practice 30 minutes a day for 8 weeks in a row, we can see structural changes in your brain, and therefore you have the functional changes in your brain. Yeah.
Is that 30-minute sessions, or is that broken up?
30-minute sessions. So far, that's the research we have, right? And we're doing a lot of things. I'm really excited about this. Polly's heard about this, but we have an app that's coming out. Again, the students said, give me an app, right? But so they can push the practices to them during the day so they can start building up to and practicing different types of brain changing strategies throughout the day. So we have that coming. We've tested it, made a lot of changes, and so we're bringing that. So that might be kind of fun. And this is really important, avoiding attachment to judgment. Like, I'm not doing enough, or I'm not practicing right, or I'm going to beat myself up because I only did 2 minutes today instead of 5 minutes. Because when we go into judgment, we go into storytelling. And remember, what you focus on changes the structure and function of your brain. So when I discovered that, I thought, I'm going to quit focusing on how I'm not enough, or how I'm not good enough, or what I'm not doing that's enough. Because I'm wiring that for reaction, that every time something happens, then I make it about me not being enough. Immediately, right? Because that's how I wired my brain. Ha. And then just practice inquiry. Like, what is this? What is this? What am I experiencing? What is this? What's true for me? Remembering that what's true for you in this moment is not what's true for you, is not what's true for you, not what's true for you. It's really fascinating. Practice inquiry and hold no expectations for your practice, just holding an expectation to practice in whatever way that arises for you, whatever way that's accessible. So with our work here, what we're doing is we're inviting in a perspective of holistic learning and development by taking, integrating like the coursework or things that students are getting off the web or in their life experiences, integrating that as sort of what they know to be true or what research says is true, and then inviting them into this attention, emotion, and cognitive regulation training so they start bringing in what they're feeling, what they're sensing, what they believe, right? All of who they are instead of who they think they're supposed to be, but all of who they are, integrating that. And then giving them these emotion regulation training exercises, which we didn't go over today, but you get the start of it. So they can manage their own, or I should say, regulate their own emotional reactivity to being in ambiguity, to being in uncertainty, to being in conflict, to being in, I don't know how I feel or think about this right now, right? But it is, but I'm here with it. So this is sort of our invitation. We call it integrative inquiry and getting students just into this space. And then what we're trying to do is lead into like really intentional choice making where they own the choices and the consequences of their choices, foreseen and unforeseen. So we have a minute left. And with that, would you just like to quickly share out loud some ideas that you might think you could take away and integrate into your day-to-day or into your organization?
I'd be particularly interested in seeing what faculty do routinely in the classes as a teaching technique. You know, maybe you have a class just take 15 seconds to
yes, we have. Thank you for the ability to do the self-effacing or whatever, the self-whatever promotion. Yes, we have lots of ideas. And beginning meetings with focused breathing, beginning classroom with focused breathing. And we started in our department beginning meetings with also just recognizing the human experience. And which I didn't role model here, but is there anything that's happening in your life that would keep you from fully being in this meeting? You know, and it's awesome because we're finding out what's happening with people's lives. You know, it's and then there's a great opportunity for compassion practices, right? And it's just been really fun. So that's just one of them. Yeah. Because this is, you know, I keep thinking in education, we forget that we're in the human learning and development. It's like humans having a human experience, trying to facilitate other humans' learning and development experience. And we like pretend that we're not human. It's so funny. It's not actually funny. It's created a lot of pain and suffering, I think. And so that's what our intention is to say. Let's bring back the human part of our lives and our work lives. Good. It's 1:02. I apologize for keeping you, but I hope this generates some more ideas. If you have any questions, feel free to sing out. Thank you. Oh, yeah.
Can you share at this point some of the results of the research that you guys have done on the behavior changes and learning?
It's so powerful. So first off, our research has been around 16 weeks of engagement in these practices, so 16 weeks. And we have pre and post data and 360 data to show significant decreases in stress and anxiety, significant increases in attention, emotion, and cognitive regulation, some significant increases in some critical thinking dispositions, which has led us to believe that we don't actually know what critical thinking is. So we just unpacked that even more. Like, okay, training attention is important for analytical reasoning. If I don't know what I'm paying attention to, right? So we're unpacking that more. And then the other pieces that we're really interested in is the compassion piece, just the offering kindness in whatever form that might be. And that has probably been where we've seen the most profound transformations. Family members have reported transformations in the participants. Because, again, our students are graduate students, master's and doctoral students. But we've also seen this. We did a pilot project in a sorority and did a pilot project with some STEM undergraduate students. I would say we've seen lots of changes in the way people communicate and in the ways that they collaborate. So we haven't measured whether they collaborate more, but in the ways that they collaborate. So people feel listened to more. They feel heard more. We teach how to have a difficult conversation and whether to have a difficult conversation, like when to know, when to discern. Yeah, thank you. Yeah, and so, yeah, and that's the unpacking over the 16 weeks. And what we are seeing is students, I've never, as a teacher, experienced students bringing their whole selves to class, like really speaking from their faith, their spiritual beliefs, their cultural beliefs, and watching the class not react, but respond. Like, I may not agree with you, right? And thank you for sharing your experience. Like, now that's a piece of a missing puzzle if we're going to create the solution. It's just really, it really moves me. And in my 28 years of teaching, until I started teaching this stuff, was the first time that students said, this has changed my life. Like, I don't know why research or assessment didn't change their lives before, but... So that's really cool.